What is evolutionary architecture? Hello friends, today we will be reviewing Evolutionary Architecture by Neil Ford. My name is Vikas Kearney. I have more than 20 years of experience in IT industry. I am TOGAF certified architect. Do subscribe to my channel for your regular updates. Today we will be reviewing Evolutionary Architecture book by Neil Ford. Neil Ford is a very experienced architect from ThoughtWorks. I have attended some of his architectural seminar, which were awesome. Why we need evolutionary architecture? When we start architecting for a system, first we go through the business requirements. Does our architecture support business requirements? Once we have figured out, we worry about non-business requirements, lot of utilities like availability, scalability, usability, feasibility, and lot of these utilities are stand conflict with each other. We have to create a balance between these utilities. For example, scalability and performance. If we need performance, we have to make sure there is no inter-process communication or inter-boundary communication. If the application is staying on the one machine with no communication across boundaries, it's the fastest application. But it comes to scalability. If we want to deploy our application on the cloud, make sure it's available 24/7, it can take million hits, then we have to deploy our application into components. And these components need to be deployed on different machines. So where all this communication between the processes, machines comes into picture. So our performance goes down, but the scalability comes up. So as a architect, we have to maintain a fine balance between these conflicts, between these requirements, come up a smaller plan, smarter plan. So add to this utilities, Neil Ford suggests we need to add evolvability to our architecture. Why we need? Over the time, architecture degrades. We are lot of architects, we design system to make sure that system has separation of concerns. You have business layer, data layer. Whereas the developers, they like to bypass these boundaries, service layer. Why I need a service layer? I'm not doing any processing on the service layer. I just need a business layer and data layer. Why not bypass the service layer? So we can see over the time the application degrades, and there are a lot of things going out of our control. Let's take the example of microservices architecture. There was a Linux software available free, and then they figure out that it can be, you can, hardware is cheap, you can provision using Chef this Linux software, add machines at very small cost. So comes the microservice architecture, where we deploy these components over multiple machines using the Docker technology, Docker container. So this Docker container put a lot of architectural concepts through a lot of old architectural concepts out of the window. So we can see things changes, the out of control, software degrades. Then comes the evolutionary architecture. Evolutionary architecture definition given by Neil is, it is guided incremental architecture. What do you mean by incremental changes? Nowadays, continuous delivery is very common. Every 2 weeks, we are doing a continuous delivery. Let me give you an example. Suppose a company have a rating system. So it was rating as 1 star, 5 star. They developed a new mechanism, new ability. You can rate 1/2 star. So now you deploy a new component which can rate 1/2 star also, 1 star also, 5 star also, and you have old component which just rate 1 star, 5 star. So new most of the application will start using the new services once there's no consumer is using the old service. So this old service can be put down and the new service stays. So that's the incremental delivery, incremental change is affecting the architecture. So now comes the guided part. Once we have discovered some abilities, maybe scalability, maybe usability, availability, we have to make sure over the time these architectural concerns are not degraded. So he comes up with some concept of functions. These functions are set of some measurements to make sure our architecture is not degraded. I'll create another video on this part, how you can measure that your software is not degraded, that you no longer recognize. Then he talks about Conway's law. Conway's law is that your architecture of your application reflects the organizational structure of your company, which is very true. I know one of the software we were building with consultants. So we decided this, we are developing this part, you are developing this part, and we'll have interfaces, well-defined interfaces, how we can talk to each other. Another example would be if there are four groups working on the same application, they will design modules and interfaces, how to talk to each other. Is it that the best architecture? I don't think so, which is guided by the organization. So, but Neil Ford suggests at ThoughtWorks, what they do is they organize the team based on the functionality of the application. So based on the functionality of the application, a team is assigned to that application, and they called it anti-Conway's law. So another thing is dimensions. Lot of architects consider only the technical dimension. Nowadays, security is important, data is important, and continuous delivery has become brought operational part also into the picture. It should be easy to deploy. So as an architecture, we have to take care of all data, security, technology, and operational feasibility. So why he calls this architecture evolutionary? Why not agile? Because it is incremental and guided. In agile architecture, there's no emphasis that you want to reach a end goal. You want to preserve some architectural concerns. And why it's not called adaptable? Adaptable architecture means that you are trying to fix the architecture just to keep the lights on, just to make it work. Evolutionary architecture means you accept that changes will happen, and you may have to make huge changes to the architecture. Most of the time, architecture is defined, the decisions which are very difficult to change. Because of the continuous delivery, we don't have 5 years to plan for all the big changes on forehand. And it has gone into our psychological mindset that things are difficult to change. Evolutionary architect challenges that concept that things are difficult to change. Things can be changed if our architecture is not supporting what we intended to do. Maybe we need to relook the architecture. Maybe we need to there's a microservices giving Excel reports and that vendor is not in the market, maybe we can rewrite that microservices and only Excel microservices is affected, not other applications. So thanks for watching this video. My name is Vikas Kearney. I have more than 20 years of experience in IT industry. Do subscribe to my channel for your regular updates. Thank you.